Mr. Bergeron's on. Don't forget the popcorn, Frank.
Coming, dear.
But the benefits of home care is that home care is one-to-one. So you have a caregiver who has specialized training. You want to make sure that you're working with an agency that does train their caregivers, or that their caregivers certainly have that baseline training. And that care is one-to-one. So I'm your caregiver, and we work one-on-one for however long I'm there. I might be there for a couple hours, or I might be living in the home 24 hours and providing care during that time. Typically, there's a team of caregivers if the care is for a long period of time, so it wouldn't be just one person, because those individuals, not unlike the caregivers, you gave some great examples for your mom as well, caregivers get tired. Our caregivers get tired. So we want a team of folks that are familiar with your loved one's care to care for them. The goal is really independence, safety, and managing, you know, signs of aggression, anxiety, et cetera, et cetera. So the goals in home care are very much the same as if you were living in a facility or a residence, but the care is one-to-one. And the idea is to keep that individual as independent as possible. So the idea is not to say, let me tie your shoes, but it is to help that person to make sure when they're tying their shoes, they're not tipping over and falling on their head, you know, loss of balance or what have you. So a simple example. Care is provided when you need it. So home care is very, very flexible. So it's provided for a couple hours at a time. Maybe it's sort of a wake up and a tuck in, we sort of call it. So if someone coming in around 7 in the morning till 10, get someone up, help them with their medications, showered, meal, ready for the day, maybe prepare lunch, and then coming in the evening to do the same sort of in the reverse order, okay? We also provide care that's overnight, certainly weekends, 24/7. And again, every agency is different. Sometimes there are minimums in terms of how many hours an agency will provide care. Sometimes it's no fewer than 3. Some will do 1 at a time. Some do live-in. So again, that's all part of your research. An important message here, care is not only for the client. It is so, so important that families, whether it's a spouse or their adult children, embrace it, that the care in some ways is very much for them as well. It's to give them respite. And so I'll give you a very specific example. I actually was engaged with a conversation yesterday with a woman whose husband is 62 years old. He has a brain tumor, and it is resulting in dementia-like symptoms, if you will. She is trapped. She is absolutely trapped in that she can't, she has a job where he can actually kind of go and sit, but she cannot leave him alone. No children, really no extended family. She's like, what do I do? So here's a woman who can't even go and get her hair cut without, and she loves her husband. It's not about not loving him, but she cannot go to the grocery store. He has to be with her because he's scared, and she's scared he's going to fall, et cetera, et cetera. So in that instance, a home care agency could come in for a couple hours, one time a week, and just give her a break. So it doesn't have to be sort of this, you know, I'm going to launch into constantly having an agency sort of in our home. It might be intermittent. And in that case, it would be respite for her. So just an example. So this is a little bit of an eye chart, but you do have this in the presentation. So home care agencies provide a variety of services. Not unlike assisted living, they're based and tailored around what the individual needs. So they might be very basic, like helping to do the laundry, change the bed linens, helping with housekeeping. And then they get more progressive based on the individual's needs. So the ADLs, or activities of daily living, that Arthur mentioned, we help with those all the time. Bathing, grooming, dressing, transferring, toileting, helping with medication reminders, etc. So all agencies are not sort of, if you will, created equal. Some provide, will do medication assistance, others won't. We happen to have nurses on staff, so we can actually not only help with medication reminders, which anyone can do, but we can actually help fill the pillboxes, interact with the physician, you know, go get the prescription, et cetera, et cetera. So it's, you know, again, each entity is a little different. The other thing that we do is some really cool stuff. Like, we had a family where mom had Alzheimer's, actually it was a grandmother, I should say, and the family, the granddaughter was getting married. So dad, the grandfather, is still alive. He wants to go to the wedding. They want mom to be there, but practically speaking, because of mom's progression of the disease and both her personal care needs, you know, she wearing Depends, she could not go to the, you know, she would need some assistance. The family's like, how do we do this? We don't want to just leave mom at home. We want her to be part of this. So they hired us. We sent an aide, and that aide dressed as if they were a guest of the wedding. We introduced that aide as a, you know, friend of the family, and that aide was with grandma during that event. So grandma was in the pictures. I get goosebumps still when I talk about it. You know, she was part of that event, and the family could enjoy that event for what it was and still have her there, but not have to worry about it and not to, you know, not to be their, her direct caregiver for that day. So that sort of specialty, unique, it can be one-off type of care, is also a benefit of home care. We also provide help with hospice support, which, you know, we're not here to talk about that, in, but that sort of becomes sort of the natural progression, right, of Alzheimer's dementia. So hospice is a benefit through, you know, Medicare or Medicaid and your health insurance, but it's a sometimes those home care services are provided as a wraparound. So here's the fun question, right? We're here to talk about Alzheimer's. Can you afford it? So can you afford home care? Well, the good news is there are payment sources, right? So the Mass Home Care Program that Arthur talked about through BayPath, agencies like ours are contracted with ASAPs across the state, BayPath being the example for the Southboro area. And so the nice part is that you can receive a benefit through BayPath based on your income and eligibility and your diagnosis. And then you can also work with that same agency for private care. So let's say BayPath said you're eligible for 10 hours a week of care. Great. So that's going to be paid for because of whatever your income status is. Or it could be 40 hours. It varies. And then you say, but I need help during the evening or I need more care. Great. Well, you can work with the same agency because they're contracted with BayPath. You already have a relationship. And then you pay them privately. So there's sort of a sharing, if you will, of cost. Long-term care insurance pays for the type of services that we provide. So typically long-term care requires the individual or the family to pay up front, and then the agency works with you to submit the necessary paperwork, and then the family gets reimbursed on the back end. Sometimes the long-term care insurance policy will actually pay the provider directly. You've seen one policy. Arthur spoke about veterans aid in attendance relative to assisted living. That benefit for care is also true of home care. You have to qualify, it's the same qualifying criteria, but those dollars can also be spent to pay for home care. So that's another benefit or asset that could be used. And then your personal funds and asset. So the bad news is that Medicare doesn't pay for what we do. Medicaid doesn't pay for what private agencies provide. Whoops, there we go, sorry. Some health plans like United Healthcare and Fallon are starting to pay for kind of what we call non-medical home care. So remember, we're not the VNA. We're not the home health agency that's going to be there to provide physician-directed physical therapy, occupational therapy, you know, work with you on diabetes management specifically. This is considered non-medical, so unfortunately, sort of the benefit really is sort of out of pocket. So, I mentioned in the beginning we would talk for just a moment about finding an agency. It is really critical that you do your homework. You want to ask questions. You are the consumer. It's your hard-earned dollar. You want to make sure that someone coming into your home is someone you can trust, an agency you can work with, because remember, you're not just hiring that caregiver, that lady or gentleman, if it would be a caregiver coming into your home, you're hiring the agency. You're hiring the agency to be your team to help make sure that the caregiver is vetted, meaning did they do a background check? What kind of training do they have? In our case, we not only do Corey's or criminal background checks, we make sure they have a valid driver's license, right? Because in case that individual, they have an insured car. We actually verify that their documentation is accurate up through the Department of Homeland Security. Are they legal to work in the United States? Because you don't want something coming back around to you as the payer of those services that could affect you in a negative way. We pay for their workers' we have workers' compensation. We cover their liability and we pay their payroll taxes. So you want to kind of understand the difference between an agency and maybe hiring another entity that doesn't do these things. Training is really critical. We're talking about Alzheimer's here. So you don't want someone, I mean, I have, on the microphone. Have I worked with Alzheimer's patients and clients? Absolutely. Have I had family members? Yes, but I am not a trained caregiver. So I might be a nice person, but I'm probably not the right match for your husband, your wife, what have you, to be with that person 24/7 because I have not been trained. When you're working with a home care agency, you want to understand, what's the training? Tell me about this particular individual, et cetera, et cetera. So it's just the training is really, really important. Caregiver supervision. We do regular, I always mess this up. We do regular supervisory visits that are unannounced, meaning one of our nurses, a member of our team, will go to your house where you have scheduled care and make sure that the caregiver's there, that the caregiver has their badge on, that they're appropriately dressed, that the activities that they're doing are appropriate, that your loved one is safe, et cetera. So the that's a critical part of when I talked about you're not just hiring that agency, that caregiver, you're hiring the agency to oversee that care. And then we provide that feedback back to the family. So the adult daughter who's living out of town and her parents are, you know, in Albany, New York or what have you. So we'll say, you know, email these days or a phone call. Here's what happened. We were provided a visit today, and this is what we observed. So it's not the photo book, although that's a fantastic idea. I love that. But it is sort of, you know, real-time, same-day feedback to the family who's saying, I'm paying for this service. Like, is it worth it? Is it making a difference? Okay. So I'll just end on this note and certainly allow time for questions under Arthur's direction, but I would just reiterate that a lot of times folks that we initially get calls from are like, well, I don't know if we really need home care, and we are, you know, we're considering all of our options. Great. You should always consider all of your options. But I think folks sometimes forget that the care is not just for the individual, but it is so important that you as the caregiver have respite and have time and space to sort of still be yourself, to have social activities and to engage, because the gentleman that spoke at the beginning and provided some examples here, he hit it on the head. You know, you become isolated, it's exhausting, and you shouldn't be ashamed or embarrassed or feel like it's a failure to ask for help. So I do appreciate your time, and if you have any questions, Arthur will take those.
Shelby, thank you very much. Thank you. So that gives you a sense, I think, of what the possible services are. So kind of to summarize, you really do have three possibilities if you're Frank and Mary. The nursing home is still one of them, and MassHealth will pay for that, and the assets are going to be safe. But home care is also one of them, if you think that can work. And it may very well be that assisted living in a memory care unit is also one of them. And contrary to what many people would expect, it's probably an affordable alternative. So what you really want to look at is you want to look at all of them. The goal of all my presentations is peace of mind. The goal of this exercise is so you can sleep well at night. So I hope that this was helpful. If you've got any questions, we'd be glad to take them afterwards. All these folks have agreed to stay for a few minutes. Could I ask for a quick round of applause for my wonderful guests who are willing to come today? Thank you very much, and we'll see you next time. Thank you all.